Hello everyone, welcome to this vlog where we have a short interview with Shweta, who came to Netherlands last year around fall, right? Fall
2019.
Yeah, so this video will be very interesting because she got full scholarship, so you will get to know how you can apply full scholarship from outside Netherlands. Specifically, she's from India. And so before going into the details, we'll start the interview so that we will talk about it, you know, on the course of the discussion. So maybe we can start with the first question that we have prepared. So it's where are you from? Like, what's your academic background? Like, how did you come through that in India from to Netherlands?
Yeah, so I have completed my master's in microbiology, and I have also done my bachelor's in microbiology itself. So during my second years of master, I realized that my interest lies in the area of immunology, and specifically studying cancer biology, how cancer progresses and what are the therapies. So during that time, I was considering studying abroad, and I started looking for research programs or PhD opportunities which were in the area of immunology. And that's how I found this program at Radboud University. So it's a research program in molecular mechanism of diseases. So I applied for it, and this is what I'm doing. So I'm currently, like, it's a 2 years program. So I'm currently in my first year of the program.
Okay. Why did you want to come to Netherlands specifically in your field, and how did you find out about this program when you are looking for it? Like, because after master's, many people also like maybe go for PhD or something, but then you decided to do this. So what was your thought process? Like, what did you think?
Yeah, so I was considering doing master's during my master's itself to study abroad, but I was not sure about how will be the education system, where to start, where to apply. So during that time, I found that there are summer schools which are conducted during this period, like somewhere around August. So I was looking for PhD opportunities, actually, and that's how I came across this summer school. So what I thought was it would be a nice opportunity to understand how the education system is in different places, and then maybe I can decide where to go and what to do. So I started applying for a few summer schools, and eventually I shortlisted 2 summer schools. So one of it was in Finland and the other was in Netherlands. So I attended both of these summer schools, and when even the summer school in Finland was great. I liked the one here because I liked the way they taught things, the way research works here, and most of the course is practical based. So there, it's more of application based, and this is what I liked. The system was really very nice, and the course was really very organized. So I went back and I started looking for research opportunities in Netherlands. So during that time, I had kind of shortlisted that I want to do my further studies in Netherlands. And then I looked for PhD opportunities and research programs. But what I found was, like, during my master's, I didn't have enough practical experience. Like, you know, in India, we have, at least students from India, have more of a theoretical background during master's. And we did have like research project, but it was not very compatible with what I wanted to do because it was microbiology and I wanted to go into immunology. So I thought this research program was a very nice way to bridge between what I was lacking. And then I decided not to go for PhD and do this, because this program is kind of a gateway to PhD. So it eventually prepares you for PhD. So it's a longer route. I think most of them will not prefer. Everyone would like to go directly for their PhD. But I thought it's always good to learn. So I decided to do this, and then I'll go for my PhD. So that's how I decided Netherlands and this program.
Okay. Yeah, that's a very good point, because like, most people, I mean, when you're applying, for example, from India after finishing master's for a PhD in Netherlands, be it be any in any field, I think in some cases, as you said, like it might be difficult depending on what was your background during your master's. So in that sense, it is really good that you can like get a scholarship and get some experience and also act it as a bridge to for a next academic step. So going into that, the main point, like how did you end up getting a full scholarship, which is extremely rare, at least in Netherlands, even for a master's student. I have seen that in many cases because the number of scholarships are really less. So getting a scholarship in Netherlands is really, really like difficult. So one point I want to make before you talk about it is that I'm not talking about PhD, because I've said in many times before in the videos that almost all of the PhDs are fully funded because they are like a job here in Netherlands. So you can call it a scholarship or you can call it a salary, whatever you want to call. So we are talking about the main masters or the research programs that you apply or you can apply. So
so what you said is correct. So my program is also a research program, but you can say that it's a master level program. So it's kind of as master. So my program itself offers a scholarship. So I didn't have to apply separately for it. There was a scholarship for non-European students included in my program. So the number of the intake is very low. Like for this program, the intake is only 25 students and there are like 5 scholarships available. So it's a part of the program. So I have two scholarships. I received two scholarships, one of which covers my cost of living and the other covered my entire tuition fees. So to apply for any scholarship, I think there are like few criteria which are general. So including the one which I receive and the others which you apply. So I know there is this Tulip scholarship if students want to apply, then there is this Holland scholarship. So I had applied for them, but eventually I ended up getting the one from my program itself and it covers everything for me. So the basic criteria I would say for scholarship is first, I think your scores, your GPA matters a lot. So whether it's you're coming after your bachelor's or master's, it's very important that you have a good grade because that is the first selection point they consider whether they want to put forward the application or not. And then the second one I would say is you have to give some English proficiency test. So it's IELTS or TOEFL. So it was also a major criteria before I got the scholarship. Because as you know, in Netherlands, you don't have to know in Dutch. Like you don't have to study a specific language. All you need is a good English, good command over English language. So this was also a very important criteria for getting the scholarship. The third one was, and I think the most important is your performance at the interview. So like when they have personal interview, I remember during my interview, there were of course knowledge-based questions to test how good you are as a candidate. But there were also questions about which were testing your like personality and how you would perform in a group work or your leadership qualities. So it's very important how you present yourself. What is your personality? Does it match with what they have? So for example, I can share one question which I got was, if you're working in a group and if you're two people and you're given a group project and your marks or your grades depend on the work of both of you, and eventually your partner doesn't contribute anything, he or she doesn't contribute anything, then what would you do? Like, what would be your next step? Would you just leave the project and not do it or complete it by yourself? So these are the questions which tested how you would perform. And there were many such questions which were like testing your ability to work in group and your personality as well. So it's very important that you perform well in your interview. So these were the criteria. And the last one is motivation letter. So I think it's very important that you have a motivation letter, whether it's for PhD, your master's or your bachelor's, whatever you're applying for. So to justify that why you are an eligible candidate for the scholarship is very important. And you have to write it very short, like you cannot go on for pages and pages. I remember it was just one A4 page for me when I had to apply for the scholarship. So just in that limited words, you have to say that why you would be a good candidate. So these are a few important points which helped me to get the scholarship. And these apply in general for all the scholarships I know.
Okay. Yeah, it's very inspiring to I hope that people will like it. And one more thing I forgot to ask, add in the points. So does anyone need publications during the masters when they're applying for these kind of positions? Does it help, or what's your experience like?
Yeah, so it's not mandatory, like for your PhD or even for this research program, it's not expected that master students should have a publication. But if you have some other, like if you have poster presentations in some science conferences or you have done some research project, it helps. It definitely helps, but publication is not a mandatory requirement. And I also had this question and I asked a lot of people, but after coming here, I realized and I know that it's not important. But I think it's very important that you have some extracurricular activities because it's not just your studies, but some kind of other activities or, you know, participation in any kind of, I would say, social work, because this is what I noticed, like, your students do a lot of activities during their masters. It's not just masters or studying. They do some kind of coaching, or they have some work experience, or they teach bachelor level students. So stuff like that contributes to their profile, and that's why they end up getting admission quickly and faster than we. At least for Indian students, I can say that we just have our degrees and our GPAs, but if you have any other extracurricular activities to it, then it will really help. But yeah, like for your question, no, research publication is not at all mandatory. So yeah.
Okay, so moving on to the next question. So when you planned that you are going to apply abroad, then how much time did you take roughly to plan this, like the number of applications or for each university, and how did you apply? Like, I think it is online, but you can just briefly say like what was your thought process or how much time you took.
So during my master's only, I had decided. So in second year, I started with preparing for exams like GRE and TOEFL, and I cleared them during my master's itself. So I had enough time to look for applications and look for which universities I have to go. So basically, I can say that after shortlisting, I took 3 to 4 months for applying to different universities here in Netherlands. So I started applications somewhere around January. So for this summer intake, it opened somewhere around December end and in Jan. So I applied in January and I heard from them somewhere around April. So it was like 3 to 4 months of application procedure. There were deadlines like you have to submit this form, you have to submit your documents and stuff like that. So it took about 4 months. And after I was admitted, then the scholarship decision took about 1 month. Like I had to give an interview and then I heard from them after 1 month that I had received the scholarship. And then rest of the procedure was about 4 months, like your visa, insurance and stuff like that. So overall, you can say that it takes 8 to 9 months at least before you start. So I would suggest that you start earlier than this because I think you would also agree the main time-consuming thing is shortlisting where you want to go, like which country, which university. So once you have that, then it's a matter of few months and then it's more easy if you know where you want to start.
Okay, so ideally, I would say it will be like somewhere in the beginning of second year, right?
Yeah, somewhere around second year you should start. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So before we go to the last point, I want to say that she has a beautiful podcast and she also has a YouTube channel. So in your podcast, maybe you can say in brief, like, what do you share in your podcast? We can
Yeah.
put the link in the description below. You can find it. And yeah.
So in my podcast, I usually talk to researchers from different fields and I talk to them about their PhD journey. So how did they decide that they want to do PhD in this area and what are their struggles and how do they overcome? Because, you know, PhD is definitely not easy. It's like 4 to 6 years of hard work and failures. And I talk to them about how they deal with it and talk about their PhD journey in the podcast. Yeah.
And you also have a YouTube channel, right? That also will put in
Yeah.
the description below.
I started YouTube channel after coming here to Netherlands. I'm just trying to get used to it now. There are a few videos on the channel.
Yeah, I mean, just go there and watch it. And if you are interested in the field that she is working, then you can obviously contact her. I'll leave the details in the description below. So the final point before we end this scholarship video is, any advice or tips that you want to give to the incoming aspirants?
I would like to say that, or I would suggest that you really start planning early, like do your homework. It's not that difficult. Getting an admission or applying for scholarship is not that difficult. The procedure is really not difficult. For me, the hardest part was deciding where to go. So if you start somewhere around in second year of your master's or during, I would say, third of year of your bachelor's, at least for Indian students, we have a bachelor's degree for 3 years. So you should be able to do it. And if you start looking, I would suggest that you look for areas where, if you know, like, this country is good. Like, most of the students who want to do engineering, they end up going to Germany, or like in Netherlands, I know most of the students prefer to go to TU Delft because it's a very good university. So if you know these particular regions or countries or universities where there is good opportunity for your area, then I would suggest that just go there, go on their website. Everything is available online. Like, if you go on their page, and they have everything listed, whether they would need GRE, TOEFL, everything is available. So if you start early, and if there are specific requirements, like some language requirement, or you have to do some online course, work experience. So during your studies, you can start doing that side by side. And by the end of your master's, you're well equipped. So you know that you have, like, checked every which is necessary for the getting admission in the university, then it's easy. And I would also suggest that there are some study fairs. So if you don't know where to go and how to start, then I know that in cities in India, at least in metro cities like Bangalore, Mumbai, Chennai, there are study fairs held every time. So most of the universities come together, and then you can talk to the representatives of those universities about the course and get more information. And I know that most of the universities also organize webinars now. So you can attend those webinars. Those are really helpful. I also attended a few of the webinars, and I got most of the information from them. So I would say start early and try to get as much information as possible, and make sure that you apply for scholarships. Because if you apply to few of them, then eventually we get one or the other. So it's not that difficult.
Okay. Okay. So I hope that, again, you like this video. Then don't forget to smash the like button and subscribe to the channel, and share this video among everyone, so that they can also, like, if anyone is interested, they can get some advice to apply for scholarships and choose any university in Netherlands or Europe. And yeah, so thank you for giving your time. And in the next video, we are going to talk about her field of work, like, what is she doing? What is Shweta doing in Netherlands? And what's her field of work? And what's her future plans? And yeah, so if you're interested in her field, then do watch the second video. So see you. Bye.
Bye. Thanks, Ampit. Thank you for having me.
Yeah.